reached down and wiped our tears away. Stepped in and saved the day. But once again, I say amen, and it's still raining. And as the thunder rolls, I barely hear your whisper through the rain. I'm with you. And as your mercy falls, I lift my hands and praise the God who gives and takes away.
Good morning. Good morning. Welcome to Sedge Garden this morning. For those of y'all that are here with us, it is great to see you. For those of you that are online, welcome. Just a few announcements this morning. Hey, buddy, where are you going? Bye. Hi. Bye. The Widow and Widower's Luncheon is this Wednesday at 11:45 at Captain Tom's. So for those of you that would like to join on Wednesday, please come out for a good lunch at Captain Tom's. We also have the Tulip Circle, which will meet also on Wednesday at 1 o'clock in the Fellowship Hall. So all ladies are welcome to attend the Tulip Circle. And then we also are in return starting in March, which is Friday. I don't know what happened to February. But so starting March 1st through the 31st is our cereal drive. So if y'all remember last year, the halls were filled with boxes of cereal. It's a big competition throughout the church to see who can bring in the most cereal boxes. And Miss Ann makes this really nice cereal trophy for the winner. So bring in your cereal March 1st through the 31st. Those are all the announcements that I have this morning. Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for bringing us here this morning. Thank you for the sun that's shining and the smiling faces that are here with us today. God, be with us in the service. Just fill our hearts with the music, the sermon, and the words that are spoken. And just let us know that you're here. In your name we pray. Amen. Please stand and sing with us.
I speak the name of Jesus over you. In your hurting, in your sorrow, I will ask my God to move. I speak the name 'cause it's all that I can do. In desperation, I'll seek heaven and pray this for you. I pray for your healing. The circumstances would change. I pray that the fear inside would flee in Jesus' name. I pray that a breakthrough would happen today. I pray miracles over your life in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Every promise he is faithful to keep. I speak the name no grave could ever hold. He is greater, he is stronger, he's the God of possible. I pray for your healing, the circumstances would change. I pray that the fear inside would flee in Jesus' name. Circumstances would change. I pray that the fear inside would flee in Jesus' name. I pray that a breakthrough would happen today. I pray miracles over your life in Jesus' name. I pray for revival, for restoration of faith. In Jesus' name.
If garden kids will come down, please.
Good morning. So, I wasn't here last week, and I brought apples. And I thought we'd do a little lesson about apples and bruising. Is that okay? No, I'm kidding. But I had several people see me come in with apples and say, Miss Michelle did a lesson on apples last week. And I said, oh, goodness. Well, but I have a totally different lesson about apples. Isn't that awesome? We can learn so much about apples, or with apples. Yeah, so actually, I'm going to pass them around. Just pass them. Don't take a bite, okay? Just touch it. Touch it. Don't take a bite. Yeah. Oh, why don't you want to bite that one?
Because it's plastic.
Oh. Is the first one plastic? Is that a real apple? Is it real? Yeah, pass it so she can feel it. There you go. Yeah, make sure Katie and Tate over there get to touch it. Yeah. Oh, Marcella, look. Touch that one. Is it real?
No, we got a real one, and pass it over there. Let them see it. Yeah, we got a real one. And did you get it? Pass it that way. Our friends on that side didn't get it. There we go. Oh, yeah. That's a real one. And this one is what? Fake. That's the word I was looking for. Fake. Yes. So which one would you like to eat if I was going to let you eat it? The real one. Thank goodness. Yes. Don't eat the fake one. That would be bad, right? I think actually there's styrofoam in there. It would be dry. It wouldn't be good. Yeah. Well, the reason I brought one real and one fake apple and asked you which one you wanted to eat is because we tend to like real things better than fake things, right? Isn't that true? If I said I was going to pay you, but then I paid you with fake money, would you be happy? No, right. We tend to like real things better than fake things. And the reason I'm asking you this today and having you focus on that is because we've been learning about kindness all month. All month. We've been learning about kindness, right? We learned about who to be kind to, when to be kind to them, right? How to be kind to them. And we talked about a bunch of different groups of people that we should be kind to. And today, this is really cool, you guys are going to be super kind because you get to go to Petco and buy stuff for Juliet's house. That's right. We're doing that. That's fun. And it's kind. But here's the thing. If you had fake kindness, do you think it would be as effective? No. Yeah. So most people can see right through that fake kindness, right? So my closing point on kindness, because it is one of the fruits of the Spirit, which is why I brought the apples, is that we've got to be real kind, not fake kind. We got to be real kind. How are we going to stay in real kindness? How are we going to stay there? What do we need to do? Who do we need to stay connected to?
God.
Yeah, we got to stay connected to God. We got to stay in the Word. We got to stay in prayer. We got to keep coming to church. Let God fill us, because when He fills us, guess what comes out? The fruit, kindness, the fruits of the Spirit, and kindness is one of them. So pray with me. Dear God, thank you so much for all the examples of Jesus' life that taught me how to be kind. Help me stay connected to you so that my kindness is real and not fake. In Jesus' name, amen.
Good morning. It's good to see you here. It's good to be with you in worship. Boy, spring is just
right there. It's just right there.
Anyway, I'm continuing my sermon series on prayer, and looking forward to sharing this with you. Amanda and I don't always plan our work together, but today works out because I'm in some ways talking about real prayers and fake prayers. I just called them a joke instead of a real prayer, but anyway. I'd like to offer a real prayer now. Holy God, we have gathered by the invitation of your Spirit, and we ask for the continued grace of your Spirit to open our hearts and minds to your word so that we might respond and live as your people. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So I'm going to start by reading from Luke's Gospel, chapter 18. Verses 9 through 14. He also told this parable to some who trusted in themselves that they were righteous and regarded others with contempt. Two men went up to the temple to pray, one a Pharisee and the other a tax collector. The Pharisee, standing by himself, was praying thus: God, I thank you that I am not like other people, thieves, rogues, adulterers, or even like this tax collector. I fast twice a week. I give a tenth of all my income. But the tax collector, standing far off, would not even look up to heaven, but was beating his breast and saying, God, be merciful to me, a sinner. I tell you, this man went down to his home justified rather than the other. For all who exalt themselves will be humbled, but all who humble themselves will be exalted. This is the word of God for you, the people of God. Thanks be to God. I am a member of the Hobby of the Month Club. I've probably had 27 different hobbies over the years, and some of them have been practical, some of them have been artistic, and with every art form that I've ever attempted, there is this common experience of learning some of the basics of that art form that you didn't know because you've never done that before. But there are rules that everybody else who's ever done this knows, and they follow these rules. And they tend to be basic rules of aesthetics, rules that lead some things to be more beautiful than others. I mean, we love these stained glass windows, but the person who designed those was following some rules, or else it would just look like I made them, and they wouldn't be as beautiful. But once you learn those key basics, it's like your brain shifts, and suddenly you understand exponentially more about what it is you're trying to do. I'll give you for instance, I took up photography for a little while, and I haven't taken a picture in a while, but anyway, one of the things you learn in Photography 101 is the rule of thirds. Anybody ever heard of this? So if you want to instantly improve your family photos, follow the rule of thirds, which is basically draw an imaginary tic-tac-toe board over the frame. And instead of putting people dead center, or instead of putting the major lines in your photograph dead center, just put them off to the side. Put your subject on one of those tic-tac-toe lines. Or especially where those tic-tac-toe lines join. If your subject is on one of those lines or one of those intersections, your photos will instantly be more visually appealing. There you go. Now all your photos are better. So I believe that prayer has some rules of aesthetics. I don't want to say that prayer is formulaic, although there are things. I mean, y'all know about an Acts prayer, you know? An Acts prayer is adoration, confession, thanksgiving, and supplication. You just follow that little acronym, and you got yourself a fine prayer. But I don't want to say it's formulaic. But it does follow certain rules, and we tend to spot these aesthetics when they're missing. So an extreme example of this is the well-known prayer of NASCAR legend Ricky Bobby. So if you don't know, if you're not catching this reference, just know that it's a comedy routine from a movie where the actor Will Ferrell prays this ridiculous prayer, and it's hilarious because we know it's ridiculous. We know he's not trying to pray a real prayer. And we know it's funny because it violates almost every rule that we could come up with for a prayer. It's biblically illiterate. It's based more on culture than theology. It's selfish. It's prideful. It's commercial. And it really doesn't seek to help anyone. We know that a prayer that's characterized by those things is a joke. It's a fake prayer. It's not a real prayer. Now, and we all laugh at movie prayers because we know as the viewer that they're not real. We just kind of intuit that they are a joke, even though they appear to be real. And so what I'm interested in is, how do we tell the difference? How do you, if you had to write it down, how do we know the difference between a joke prayer and a real prayer? Think about that. I would look forward to your responses about that. My answer is that there's an aesthetic of prayer at work, an aesthetic that lets us know that a prayer is honest, that a prayer is directed to the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, that a prayer reflects an open heart, that a prayer is opens the one praying to correction, that a prayer seeks for the good of others, seeks a right relationship with God. All those things are involved. So I want you to take a minute and turn to your neighbor and say and name something that you think makes for a joke prayer, and name something that you think makes a prayer authentic. Okay? Ready, go. I got to tell you, not only am I tempted sometimes during Advent to pray to the baby Jesus, I'm also tempted to begin weddings by saying, "Marriage," for those of you who catch that reference. I would be fearful to try to list everything that makes a prayer a prayer. Right? But I think we all have a kind of intuitive sense for what makes a prayer, and what makes it a joke. One of the things that I think marks a prayer is that it is led by the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit leads us to a place where, as the psalmist says, our prayers are incense to the Lord, where our prayers are a thoughtful, artful expression of our faith, of ourselves, of our longings. And I think that's the, if I'm going to give you a bumper sticker today, that's it. The Spirit guides us into better prayer. And a good prayer is one that that participates with the Spirit's work. I think I'm interested in this question of what makes for a real prayer, what makes for a joke, because in this parable that Jesus tells us out of Luke this morning, the difference isn't always readily apparent, especially among the us religious types. Jesus points out the differences between the prayers of this Pharisee and the tax collector, and shows us that our prayers can tell us a lot about the inner life of the one doing the praying. The Pharisee, you see, is trying to use this prayer as insurance. The Pharisee is trying to use the prayer as a security fence that keeps certain people out. The Pharisee is using his prayer to ensconce what he already thinks to be true. There's no openness to any learning in the Pharisee's prayer. While the tax collector is using prayer to open himself. The tax collector's prayer is helpless before God and submissive before God. And Jesus clearly points to the tax collector's prayer as being a better model for us. So now we know, we can kind of glean from this example that a vulnerability with God and not contempt toward other people is part of what makes for a good prayer. And I would imagine if we really started to study the scriptures in that way, with that question in mind of what makes for a good prayer, we could come up with hundreds of contrasts like that. So that's just identifying, I think, part of what we know because we've come to church or because we've showed up in Sunday school over time or because we've had prayer in the home. That aesthetic within us has kind of built up over time to help us identify what's a good painting and what's not. What's a good prayer and what could be improved. One of the reasons that we say the Lord's Prayer so often is it's like playing scales and arpeggios for a musician. It is playing scales and arpeggios for the soul. If we can pray as Jesus taught us, if we can allow that prayer to sink in, then praying becomes more like second nature. We don't have to think so hard about, okay, what name should I call God? Okay, what should I pray for? Okay, what should come next in the prayer? It begins to be more like riding a bike. And then a proficiency in something as basic as the Lord's Prayer is going to give shape to any other kind of prayer that we write or utter. It's not so much a matter of knowing the Lord's Prayer by heart as much as it is a matter of letting our heart know the Lord's Prayer. And so when that happens, it just is kind of a natural outgrowth into the other ways that the Spirit is leading us into prayer. What we know from the Lord's Prayer echoes what we know from reading the Psalms, which is our basic prayer book, or it helps us understand words from praise songs or hymns. And then when it comes time to pray, we can pick up those phrases and snippets and images to help form our own prayers. I think knowing the Lord's Prayer and all of the other forms of prayer that we have, we do those things frequently so that we have an innate sense and direction, an intuition for how to pray. I think that if the Pharisee in Jesus' parable had been in the habit of saying the Lord's Prayer, the likelihood of his viewing other people with such contempt would have gone way down. It's not a guarantee, but I think it would have, the likelihood would have gone down. The risk of being thick-headed isn't completely eliminated just because you pray a lot. But prayer isn't magic. But when we pray together, when we pray in community, it helps shape our aesthetic. It helps shape our soul. So this doesn't happen all at once. It takes time. It's like water rushing over rocks. It takes time to smooth off our rough edges. A good prayer doesn't certify us for anything. You know, it doesn't. We don't earn points or level up. But those formative images and formative experiences with prayer, they add up as they take place in 1,000 different ways. As they take place with the Lord's Prayer, as they take place with reading prayers that other people have written, as they take place as we are saying table graces, as we are listening to our brothers and sisters when they pray, as we spend time in prayer, as we spend time in reading Scripture, all of this is guiding us. This is all different ways that the Spirit is leading our prayers. I mentioned that the Psalms are our basic prayer book, and I wanted to highlight one particular psalm today, Psalm 141, because I think it's a good teacher of prayer. It points us to some things that make for a good prayer. It's humble. It both asks for help and tries to take responsibility. It strives for goodness while admitting that there's room for improvement on the part of the person praying. So I would like to read the 141st Psalm for you and listen for those things that form what a good prayer is. I call upon you, O Lord. Come quickly to me. Give ear to my voice when I call to you. Let my prayer be counted as incense before you, and the lifting up of my hands as an evening sacrifice. Set a guard over my mouth, O Lord. Keep watch over the door of my lips. Do not turn my heart to any evil, to busy myself with wicked deeds in company with those who work iniquity. Do not let me eat of their delicacies. Let the righteous strike me. Let the faithful correct me. Never let the oil of the wicked anoint my head, for my prayer is continually against their wicked deeds. When they are given over to those who shall condemn them, then they shall learn that my words were pleasant. Like a rock that one breaks apart and shatters on the land, so shall their bones be strewn at the mouth of Sheol. But my eyes are turned toward you, O God, my Lord. In you I seek refuge. Do not leave me defenseless. Keep me from the trap that they have laid for me and from the snares of evildoers. Let the wicked fall into their own nets while I alone escape. So read that some later today or this week. I think that when we pray with the heart of faith, we do ask that a guard be set over our mouth. That when we participate with the Spirit in prayer, we are asking God to keep our heart from doing evil, the kinds of evil that we might not even think as troublesome. But we are asking God to illumine our heart. And just doing all of this over and over and over and over and over again, through the days, through the weeks, through the months, through the years, trains us into knowing the difference between a prayer that's a joke, a prayer that's self-serving, and a prayer that's authentic, a prayer that seeks union with God and neighbor. There, I've said enough about prayer for today. But I want to draw out this one last verse. I think that this parable of the Pharisee and the tax collector bring out the truth of Psalm 51 that says to us in such great wisdom, "The sacrifice acceptable to God is a broken spirit, a broken and contrite heart, O God, you will not despise." Thanks be to God. Amen. So I want to make this morning's time of prayer a little bit different. I've asked Tommy to prepare provide some music, and I'm just going to hold a minute or two for them to play music. And I want to invite you to take advantage of the chancel rail in prayer, whether it's for yourself or for somebody else. And I know it's not always, we're not always in the habit of coming to the rail for prayer. So if there are one or two of you that really don't need to come to the rail for prayer, just come anyway and kind of break the ice for the rest of us. What I'll do is after a minute or so of praying at the rail with some music, I'll start to read the 141st Psalm again as our prayer for the morning and close it with the Lord's Prayer. And so I invite you to pray together. Thank you. call upon you, O Lord. Come quickly to me. Give ear to my voice when I call to you. Let my prayer be counted as incense before you, and the lifting up of my hands as an evening sacrifice. Set a guard over my mouth, O Lord. Keep watch over the door of my lips. Do not turn my heart to any evil, to busy myself with wicked deeds in company with those who work iniquity. Do not let me eat of their delicacies. Let the righteous strike me. Let the faithful correct me. Never let the oil of the wicked anoint my head, for my prayer is continually against their wicked deeds. When they are given over to those who shall condemn them, then they shall learn that my words were pleasant. Like a rock that one breaks apart and shatters on the land, so shall their bones be strewn at the mouth of Sheol. But my eyes are turned toward you, O God, my Lord. In you I seek refuge. Do not leave me defenseless. Keep me from the trap that they have laid for me, and from the snares of evildoers. Let the wicked fall into their own nets, while I alone escape. Teach us how to pray, O Lord. Open our hearts to prayer. Open our hands in response to your presence, to love our neighbor as we love ourselves. All this we ask in Jesus' name, who taught us to say when we pray, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever. Amen.
Every morning before I head out, I bow my head and I say a little prayer. First I thank God for all he's done for me, and then I ask him to give me strength. Lord, let my neighbor see you as my Savior. Teach me the right thing to say and do. Lord, give me wisdom to act as a Christian. Lord, let me please you the things that I do today. And every evening before I go to sleep, I bow my head and I say a little prayer. Again I thank God for helping me through another day. And Lord, forgive me if I sin along the way. Lord, my neighbor, see you as my Savior. Teach me the right things to say and do. Lord, give me wisdom to act as a Christian. Lord, let me bring to you the things that I do today. Let my neighbor see
Life at Sedgwick Garden this week, but it's a fun one. Our kids and our youth and others from the church participated in the Fat Tuesday Pancake Supper on February the 13th. They had all different types of pancake toppings. I think pretty much anything that you could think to put on a pancake was available. And they made prayer tracing patterns with puff paint to use as they pray throughout the Lenten season. So to go along with Dan's sermon series throughout Lent. They also had pancake races and pancake flipping competitions. So all sorts of fun had during the Lenten season or during the Fat Tuesday meal. As always, as these things happen in our church, they can't be done without the giving in our church. So there are plates at each entrance to the sanctuary. You can also give online through the QR code on the website or send in a check to the office. Please stand and sing our last song with us.
Be my soul.
Finally, beloved, whatever is true, whatever is honorable, whatever is just, whatever is pure, whatever is pleasing, whatever is commendable, if there is any excellence, and if there is anything worthy of praise, think about these things. That's a pretty good rule for prayer right there. Keep on doing the things that you have learned and received and heard and seen in me, and the God of peace will be with you. Go in that peace. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
I really do like this.